Air travel can be stressful, perhaps even more so for a person with a disability, certainly. But we've learned a Lowcountry woman was brought to tears by what happened to her on a JetBlue flight. Tonight, she's telling her story only to ABC News 4. Tara Jabor is live at Charleston International. Tell us what happened, Tara, and what the airline has to say about it.
Yeah, Tessa, Katie Thompson traveled from here in Charleston to New York on Monday. She says it was her first time flying with a wheelchair, and her experience left her very upset.
For almost 2 years, Katie Thompson has used a wheelchair part-time. She had a spinal injury that led to a number of surgeries. On Monday, she traveled for work with her wheelchair, something she says she was nervous about.
Every wheelchair user that has flown pretty much has some kind of bad experience to share.
Thompson says she worried her wheelchair would not make it to New York, but it did. The flight landed safely and everyone started moving.
Everybody else got off, and you know, before I knew it, the entire plane got off, and then the cleaners came on and I'm still sitting there and, you know, kind of looking around.
She was waiting on the airplane for her wheelchair.
It got to a point where it was holding up the crew. They could not leave the plane until I departed, so the new crew couldn't come on.
Then she says a manager from JetBlue approached her and said they were waiting on her chair. She told him it was unacceptable, and that is when things escalated.
And before I could even say why, he, you know, oh, well, you know, I'm not the one you should be getting mad at, and kind of like rolled his eyes and sighed and completely wanted to absolve himself of any wrongdoing. And I just, you know, it just started getting more heated.
Thompson says the experience left her in tears. She says there's a problem with the disability community and being treated fairly on airplanes.
But it still makes you feel bad about yourself. It's like these people aren't happy right now because of me, even though it's not my fault. My disability isn't my fault.
We reached out to JetBlue about the situation. They said in part, quote, JetBlue is dedicated to serving all customers and ensuring those who require mobility assistance are provided it promptly. We apologize. We did not meet the customer's expectations and are looking into her concerns, end quote.
Now, Thompson says that she waited around 20 minutes for her chair, but it wasn't that wait time that upset her. It was the manager from JetBlue. Now, JetBlue says they are looking into her concerns about that crew member. Working for you live in North Charleston, Tara Jabor, ABC News 4.
Thank you, Tara. And the U.S. Department of Transportation has steps to follow when there's a disability-related issue. First, request to speak with airline's complaint resolution official or supervisor. Every airline is required to have one available during operating hours. You can also contact the DOT Aviation Consumer Protection Division Disability Hotline. That number is 800-778-4838. You'll also find a link to that number, along with information on filing an official complaint in this story that can be found on the homepage of abcnews4.com.
Well, the commission decided not to decide. They deferred their decision to their next meeting in order to get more information on what the statue would be used for. Until then, the statue will stay put in the city it was erected in and later brought down in.
After a nearly two-hour discussion, the Commission on History voted to delay their decision until their next meeting. Members say they want a few more details from the Los Angeles nonprofit LAX Art on what they'll do with the John C. Calhoun statue. I went straight to the leader of that nonprofit group to ask what their goal is.
John C. Calhoun was born in South Carolina. He lived in South Carolina. A lot of history he made was made in South Carolina. His statue was in South Carolina and currently sits here now. So why is someone in California asking to borrow this statue to use it as part of an exhibition?
So, well, first of all, I know that would raise some eyebrows that folks out on the West Coast would be interested in John C. Calhoun, but he's a central figure in American history.
Hamza Walker says the statue would be part of an exhibition featuring former Confederate statues from across the nation that have been taken down. He says the goal is to spark a conversation on why there's a trend of those statues coming down. Walker says the Holy City is a key part of that movement.
Emmanuel Amy, where Dylan Roof in 2015 killed a number of members of that church, and that set off the first round of decommissioning of Confederate monuments. So Charleston is in many respects kind of central to the exhibition on those counts.
One member of the city's Commission on History, Wilmot Frazier, says this exhibit would be a great step in sparking that conversation.
This kind of exhibit, you using the pathway of art, can help us to develop a clearer idea of what it means to be American and what it means to be human.
Walker says he'll continue to work with the commission to get the statue in the exhibit, and he promises not to use it to attack the city.
The goal of the exhibition is in no way whatsoever to shame any municipality or region, but to look at these objects and to use these objects to have a conversation and to listen to one another.
Uber drivers are coming forward about strange situations on rural Lowcountry roads. Tonight, we're hearing about another suspicious circumstance. It has a woman changing her commute plans for good. And she spoke with our Floriana Boardman in an ABC News 4 exclusive.
Asia Singleton says that while she was driving on this street last night, she saw two trucks driving side by side, trying to block the car in front of her here on Canehoy Road.
It scared me. I was scared, but I know how to protect myself.
Singleton says the trucks were driving slower than 10 miles per hour with no way for the car to get out. But as more cars arrived onto the street, the trucks finally left the car alone.
When I realized what was going on, I was on the phone. And I knew that once I hit a certain point that my car was going to drop because service is terrible on that road.
Singleton had seen previous Facebook posts about suspicious vehicles, but what alarmed Singleton last night, she says the trucks had their flashers on and there was no light on the car's license plate, leaving her unable to identify the vehicles.
Those are the key points, like the full riding and the flashers and the fact that I didn't even see if they had license plates on the vehicles.
We spoke with Berkeley County Sheriff's Office, who says they continue their patrol in the area, but they need help to keep everyone safe. They say they have not received any police reports from victims other than what they have seen on Facebook, so they're calling on the community to report anything they see, especially if they are a victim of suspicious activity.
Be vigilant, be aware, take care of yourself, and if you have an opportunity to call 911 or signal to somebody else to call, we'll come as fast as we can.
Elliot Middleton, co-owner of Village Barbecue, is hosting a meeting tomorrow night for residents of Ondaw, McClellanville, and Hugie. He hopes they can come up with a plan to keep the area safe, especially in the areas with little to no cell phone service.
My vision and what I see needs to happen is safe house or checkpoints to where this, like there's a church that's at the corner of Union Road and Halfway Creek. That church needs to be a safe haven for if you have a car issue or whatever, because there's 6-7 miles of nothing but woods.
If you see any suspicious activity, make sure to report it to the police immediately.